Welcome back. What a great start we've had. We're really happy to be back and happy to have such great speakers who are obviously great teachers, and that's going to continue throughout the day. The next presenter is Steve Johnson from the University of Colorado. I'm looking at my notes and it says Aurora. I thought it was anxious.
In Aurora.
Okay. Getting it exactly correct. Steve is a professor of medicine at the University of Colorado in Aurora / Anschutz, and has a number of important administrative roles there, director of the Ryan White program. I know a number of you work in Ryan White centers, medical director of the AETC, and co-investigator of the AIDS Clinical Trials Unit there, so very involved both in teaching, patient care, management, and research. So Steve is going to talk to us about immunization. We always have a faculty dinner the night before, so we get together and talk about what we're going to talk about. And just to kind of anticipate, one of my questions from last night was, should I have another COVID boost now? And Steve was saying, you know, he's had six, and I couldn't remember eight. I can't remember how many I've had. So, just probably the fact that I'm older than he is. So welcome, Steve, and I think it's going to be good to hear your summary. Thanks.
Thank you to Dr. Volberding and the organizers for inviting me, and thank you all for attending. And thank you for mentioning John Fair, who was a mentor of mine many years ago at Northwestern. I'm going to talk with you about updates on immunizations for people with HIV. I think whether we're doing HIV primary care or consultation, these issues come up a lot, and there have been a number of updates that I want to mention today. I have no financial disclosures, and these are the learning objectives. We'll talk about a variety of vaccines, I'll concentrate on the ones listed here, hepatitis B, the meningococcal vaccines, Mpox and COVID-19, our current pandemics, and then talk about new recommendations for pneumococcal pneumonia and then respiratory syncytial virus. And then kind of a theme that I'm going to mention a few times is about timing of vaccines, because I think that's a practical issue when people present and they need eight vaccines and they don't want to get eight vaccines. How do you make decisions about what to give them and so on? So I think this is accurate. Vaccines are available now for 34 infectious diseases. Obviously, one of the big stories in public health has been the ability to develop vaccines for a variety of conditions. And of course, we've had multiple iterations of COVID-19 vaccine in my arm, as I just mentioned, and then and new vaccines for respiratory syncytial virus, and then for maybe less common diseases like chikungunya, but you can see it's quite a list. So what I've done is I've kind of fashioned an immunization schedule that looks like the ACIP immunization schedule for adults, but I've adjusted it a bit to represent an HIV adult immunization schedule, and use kind of the same color codes. That yellow is something that everyone should get. The purple is for certain subgroups that have risks, or in this case, for example, the RSV vaccine in pregnancy. And then the blue represents those that are shared decision making, and that is where the provider and the patient actually discuss the individual's risk and then make a decision either to vaccinate or not to vaccinate. So we'll start with hepatitis B. Hepatitis B is obviously an important comorbidity, co-infection in HIV. Hepatitis B-related cirrhosis and hepatocellular carcinoma are an important cause of death, especially in this era where people are infrequently dying of AIDS. This just looks at the reported cases of hepatitis B in the U.S. There's been a gradual decline given the widespread use of immunizations. And I think you know that in the general population, there now is a universal vaccine, universal recommendation for hepatitis B vaccine up to age 59. But of course, for the longest time, we've recommended these vaccines in people with HIV. This is just a nice slide from the hepatitis B curriculum at the University of Washington. It's a great website for hepatitis B, hepatitis C, and HIV. I should mention here that we tend to use kind of brand names with vaccines for recognition. Sometimes with CME programs, we like to de-emphasize brand names, but I think, you know, it's people tend to know these vaccines by the branded name, so that's why I've included it. So a variety of vaccines, and I'll point out the one in 2017, Heplisav-B, because we're going to talk more about that. So one of the good sources of information on immunizations in general are our federal opportunistic infection guidelines, and so I referenced these some of the recommendations here. This is the recommendations for our primary vaccination schedule, which are really double dose of the standard vaccines, or the Heplisav-B, which is the adjuvanted vaccine that we think on average is more immunogenic. Twinrix, which is a standard mixture of the hepatitis A and B vaccine, is still listed as a convenient approach for individuals that are seronegative for both of those viruses. And for all vaccines, regardless of their potency, we do measure titers afterwards to document seroprotection. Now, one of the things that I mentioned about is focusing on timing. And so the question is, you have a new patient, perhaps with a low CD4 count, do you delay hepatitis B vaccine? And the recommendations from the guidelines is it should not defer them because some people actually do respond to vaccination. As an aside here, I mentioned that some of our most commonly prescribed antiretroviral agents, of course, have hepatitis B activity and may act as sort of prep agents against hepatitis B. But as we see kind of the growing use of two-drug regimens and injectable antiretroviral therapy and so on, we may see less of that. So having a response to hepatitis B vaccine is very important. Hepatitis non-response to the vaccine is a pretty common finding, and so there are guidelines for revaccination for people that do not generate antibody after the first course of therapy. And in this, the guidelines recommend that if somebody has relatively advanced disease, low CD4 counts, and don't respond, it may make sense to wait a little while until immune reconstitution, CD4 count recovery, and viral suppression before re-immunizing. Now, one of the studies that we saw at CROI here in 2024 was a study of this adjuvanted vaccine that we call Heplisav-B. And this was a study looking at two doses of Heplisav-B, three doses, and then comparing it to one of the standard hepatitis B vaccines and showing both the two-dose series and the three-dose series have a higher rate of seroprotection that is generating antibodies and so on. And this has been seen outside of HIV. At the institution I work at the University of Colorado Health System, we've actually adopted Heplisav-B as our sole hepatitis B vaccine for our health system. So it's really an important vaccine, and I think it's likely cost-effective because there'll be fewer revaccinations. The other kind of situation with hepatitis B that I want to mention, because it's kind of a nuanced thing, and that is a portion of people, when you do serologic testing, have an isolated hepatitis B core antibody. And there is a kind of a differential diagnosis of this, and including a false positive result. But especially in people with HIV, this may often indicate remote hepatitis B infection, where they've lost surface antibody. And so the guidelines recommend that if you have this pattern, you vaccinate with one standard dose of vaccine and then check titers, because if individuals have been exposed before, they'll have a robust response to just a single dose of the vaccine. And you can see if you generate a high titer here, then it should be completed. The other question that comes up with hepatitis B is, do we routinely do surface antibodies yearly and so on? I don't think we know the answer to that. I think the guidelines say some experts would, but I would say we've not been routinely doing that in our practice. So when I talk about meningococcal disease, a number of years ago, almost 10 years ago now, because of the reported increased incidence of meningococcal disease in people living with HIV, there was a recommendation to recommend the meningococcal conjugate vaccines for all people living with HIV. Of course, meningococcal disease is uncommon in the general population, but of course has a significant mortality rate. And this is just a table from the initial MMWR publication. Sorry if the, actually the font looks pretty good on the big screen, but this is from the MMWR initial guidelines back in 2016. All right, well, we're to our first poll question here, and we're going to talk about the other meningococcal vaccine, the Group B vaccine. So in my HIV clinical practice, I provide this Group B vaccine to A, all people with HIV, B, a subset of people with HIV with additional risk for meningococcal infection, a subset of people with HIV with additional risk for gonococcal infection, or then D, I do not provide this vaccine to people with HIV at this time. And it, and if you don't provide direct care, just maybe you can answer as if your colleagues that you work with. Just wait a few more seconds here. Interesting, yeah. 50% of people provide this vaccine to all people. That's ahead of the curve. That's an interesting finding. We'll talk about that a little bit more now. So there is this interest that the Group B vaccines, one of the specific Group B vaccines, might have some protective offense against gonorrhea. Of course, the meningococcus is Neisseria meningitidis, and gonococcus is Neisseria gonorrhea. So they do share some surface proteins. And so there have been a series of studies. I just list one, because this was one of the early studies that seemed to show a protective effect of this Group B vaccine against gonorrhea. And so now the question is whether this can hold up in clinical trials. And this was presented at CROI. This is a DoxyVax story, study. You're going to hear a bit more about DoxyPep in one of our later lectures. But there was also an arm that randomized to the meningococcal Group B vaccine. And you can see on the right side here, the graph, the blue represents the vaccine arm, the red represents the placebo arm, and so on. And there was a trend, but did not reach statistical significance. And so there is a ongoing phase two placebo-controlled study that is comparing that is randomizing between the Bexsero, which is one of the Group B vaccines, and placebo. And I know some of the faculty members, I think, work at sites that are enrolling for this. It's an international trial, and hopefully that enrollment will complete sometimes next year, and maybe we'll get a more definitive answer from a randomized clinical trial. So at this point, you know, it's not routinely indicated for adults and adolescents, at least in our current iteration of our guidelines. And so the Group B vaccine is given to the subset of individuals that have other risk factors, for example, people that are post-splenectomy or have other risks for meningococcal disease in general. One of the other developments in vaccines for a meningococcal vaccine is the first pentavalent meningococcal vaccine. So combining the four serogroups in the conjugate vaccine with the group B, and this was approved and is now available. It's primarily approved for use in people 10 to 25 years of age, and so it may be given in that subgroup when both vaccines are indicated. But you can kind of think that this, with a little more information about the group B vaccine and maybe some protective effects against gonorrhea, you kind of see how this might potentially become a useful vaccine in HIV. There's actually a second pentavalent meningococcal vaccine that is currently undergoing FDA review. All right, so we'll switch now to Mpox, and Mpox, of course, was an unexpected pandemic in 2022, and I've just included the epidemic curve for 2022 on this slide, and you can look at the y-axis and see it involved many thousands of cases. And then, you know, through a combination of people acquiring immunity from infection, from vaccination, perhaps from behavior change, then there was a decline and so on. And 2023 was a quieter year, with 335 reported cases. It's kind of picked up again this year, and last I looked at the national data, 744 cases reported. And so I think this is a infection that has the potential to kind of reemerge, and so I think it's an important thing to talk about. One thing I wanted to mention, which was just kind of a stunning finding, was the CDC report about the Mpox cases that were reported at the Conference on Retroviruses last year, because they reported on 103 people who were hospitalized with severe manifestations of Mpox, and of whom 21% died. But the association with HIV was pretty dramatic. Actually, 87% of those were people living with HIV. The majority had a low CD4 count. And only 18% were on ART. So it really underscores Mpox is an opportunistic infection. So especially among people with advanced disease who are not on antiretroviral therapy responding, it can be a very, very serious disease. So there are the CDC recommendations for the Mpox vaccine. This is one of those shared decision making. So, you know, if somebody is not sexually active or in a long-term monogamous relationship, you know, they may not be a candidate for the vaccine. So these are kind of the things to think about in terms of providing the vaccine. And I think this is pretty straightforward here, but certainly people who are sexually active, multiple partners, and so on. But I think, you know, in our clinic, there's an important subset of people who have gotten the Mpox vaccine and a subset of people who have elected not to get the vaccine. Just some key points about the Mpox vaccine. It can be given subcutaneous or intradermal. I think there isn't the shortage that there used to be, which was part of the reason for the intradermal. One of the interesting things I was reading about was keloid formation, and that for people that where keloids are a risk, it's important to give it sub-Q as opposed to intradermal. That was something kind of new that I discovered in preparing for this talk. The vaccine that we currently use is Jynneos, and if you recall, this is a live vaccine that's non-replicating. I'm still trying to get my head around that concept of what makes it live, but anyways, the vaccine schedule is 2 doses, 4 weeks apart, and we know that 2 doses are necessary for protection. Right now, it's not recommended for people who have already had Mpox, although there have been some cases of Mpox reported in people who have previously gotten the Mpox vaccine. The other question that comes up is people that have previously gotten the vaccine for smallpox, like in the military or so on, but the general recommendations are, because that immunity may not be sustained, it's important to provide current vaccination with the current vaccine if people are at risk. Now, I want to mention HPV vaccine, partly because it might be one of your questions, but a number of years ago, the age range expanded for the HPV vaccine. You know, of course, the perfect age for HPV vaccine is age 11 or 12 before, you know, any kind of exposure to any of the types. But, you know, for years, it was recommended up to age 26. But 5 years ago, these new guidelines came out about 27 to 45. We have 9 different types in the HPV vaccine, and perhaps even older individuals have not seen all of those 9 types and might benefit from vaccination. So this is another shared decision-making vaccine. And then maybe the important bullet to emphasize at the bottom one here is that we don't know at this point that these HPV vaccines prevent progression of existing HPV-related disease. So hint, hint. So we'll go on and talk about the COVID-19 vaccine. And when this started out, of course, we had the messenger RNA vaccines, the viral vector vaccines, and then the protein subunit vaccine. Of course, the vast majority of individuals now have gotten one of the 2 messenger RNA vaccines, although there is the Nova vaccine is still available. Now, Dr. Bedimo mentioned this, but there have been studies about the risks of COVID-19 among people living with HIV. This was one of the early studies looking at the odds ratio of a severe outcome that was defined as either ICU admission, mechanical ventilation, or death. And if you look at the left side of the slide, a CD4 count less than 200, individuals were 3 times more likely to develop that outcome. Of course, the real question in all of COVID-19 now is with the accumulation of acquired immunity from multiple vaccines and infections, you know, how important, you know, are our vaccines and antivirals and so on. But I would make the point that people with advanced disease are also the individuals that probably won't respond to vaccines. So it's very important to kind of focus on that group, use the vaccine guidelines for immunocompromised folks, and have a low threshold to use antiviral therapies as well if they become infected. Rather than list the somewhat complex schedules with COVID-19, I would just refer you to the interim clinical guidelines that the CDC maintains. Obviously, those with severe immunosuppression may have a diminished immune response to the vaccine, but there actually are good responses in a lot of people living with HIV who have normal or normalish CD4 counts with viral suppression. You'll see in the guidelines that there are separate recommendations for people who are immunosuppressed, including people with advanced or untreated HIV. And so here's the definition for advanced HIV, which is, I think, relatively intuitive: CD4 less than 200, history of an AIDS-defining illness without immune reconstitution, or symptomatic HIV. And these are the vaccines that are currently available. We have the 2023-2024 formula. Part of the reason some of us that have had 8 doses is you can get a second dose if you're over age 65. And so, but you can also get an extra dose of this formula if you're immunosuppressed. So there may be people you worry about with HIV with low CD4 counts or so on that might be a candidate for a second dose of the current formula, which is the monovalent 2023-2024 formula. The ACIP, which is the Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices, is actually meeting in June, and then we'll decide on what the vaccines look like this fall. Presumably, it'll be based on some of these latest variants, and presumably we will have a kind of evolve to what looks kind of like an annual vaccine schedule. I don't think we know for sure. You know, COVID has been kind of an interesting pandemic that keeps kind of changing with summer surges and all these kind of things that fool us, so we'll see. But I would expect a new vaccine this fall. Now, one of the things that's been kind of clear about the COVID vaccines is every iteration of the vaccine continues to show some form of efficacy. And so no matter what you kind of read on social media, you know, it's these vaccines continue to be beneficial. And this is a MMWR here from March that looked at the latest vaccine that we use, which is the monovalent vaccine, and looked at hospitalization among immunocompromised adults. And this included people with HIV. And you can see that there was still efficacy. You know, you can argue that 30-some percent efficacy is not high, but I still think if you can prevent one out of three people from being hospitalized, that's an important benefit. Now, of course, pneumococcal pneumonia, we don't seem to see this quite as frequently as we used to, you know, given the percentage of people that are in care and on antiretroviral therapy. But pneumococcal pneumonia and bacteremia, of course, is an important co-infection in people living with HIV. And so there are new pneumococcal conjugate vaccines, PCV15 and PCV20. And I felt for many years that these ACIP guidelines for pneumococcal vaccine are too complicated, and that makes it hard to kind of operationalize and to get people on vaccine. So I think the development of kind of a one-and-done strategy with PCV20 is an important development. And this slide is for individuals greater than or equal to 65 years old. And this is for the subset who are 19 to 64 and have specified immunocompromising conditions, including HIV. Again, our health system has moved to just have PCV20 as our standard vaccine throughout our health system. All right, well, the other new vaccine that's available is the RSV vaccine. Two different vaccines were approved in May of last year. One has an indication for pregnancy between 32 and 36 weeks within RSV season. But they're both indicated for the prevention of lower respiratory tract disease in persons 60 and older. And so the recommendations came out in July, and pointing out that RSV is another respiratory virus that causes substantial morbidity and mortality. In fact, there was another CDC report looking at hospitalized patients, and actually RSV had the worst prognosis compared to both influenza and COVID-19 in the current kind of vaccine era. So it's a significant disease, and so it's worthy of considering vaccination in people with HIV. So this is another vaccine with shared decision making. So adults aged greater than or equal to 60 years may receive a single dose of the RSV vaccine. The ACIP does not cite a preference between the two available vaccines, but the people that are most likely to benefit are people with chronic medical conditions, including those with moderate or severe immune compromise, but also with significant cardiovascular and lung disease. And of course, many, as Dr. Benimo mentioned, many of our patients have significant comorbidities, and so may have indications for this vaccine up and above their HIV status. And so, again, these are the guidelines. We don't really know about revaccination yet. If you've looked at the initial studies that were done of both vaccines, there was actually some protection in the second season in individuals who got the RSV vaccine. But we'll see kind of how this evolves. Now, I want to mention older people with HIV. We just looked in our clinic at the University of Colorado, and 57% of our clinic are over age 50. And so there are things to think about with vaccine considerations in older people. For influenza, the high-dose influenza vaccine or the adjuvanted influenza vaccine that's also more immunogenic is a consideration. We've already talked about the RSV infection, pneumococcal infection we've talked about, and then mentioning again that COVID-19, if you're 65 or older, you can receive a second dose of the vaccine. And the high-dose influenza vaccine is what we've been using. There are a number of studies that have shown it to be more immunogenic. And there have been some studies that show lower rates of hospitalization, and at least one study demonstrated a mortality benefit. All right, I'm going to end with a case and another poll question here. So this is a 32-year-old female, newly diagnosed with HIV infection. Her CD4 count is 130, and she is ready to begin antiretroviral therapy. She is due for a number of vaccines, including the recombinant zoster vaccine, which now has an indication for everyone 18 and older. In this clinical setting, what would be your approach to this vaccine? Would you offer the vaccine at this time along with any other vaccines? Would you defer immunization until the CD4 count is greater than 200? Would you defer immunization until she is on ART with virologic suppression? Or would you defer immunization until she reaches 50 years of age? All right, we've reached our... So that's interesting. You know, the guidelines, you know, for the recombinant zoster vaccine do not specifically recommend a delay, but it does say that some experts would consider to defer until the CD4 count is greater than 200. Many of you would also offer the vaccine. A few of you said 50 years of age. If you remember the story with the zoster vaccines, there was the initial live vaccine for people 60 and over, then the recombinant zoster vaccine, much more effective, age 50 and over, and then more recently for younger individuals who are immunocompromised, including people living with HIV. So I'll end by just saying some factors to consider in the timing of vaccines, because again, I think this is something that happens. I'm involved with a series of clinics in Colorado, and you kind of show up and somebody is behind on immunizations, and you're like, what do I give now? What do you give now? So these are some things to think about. Is this a live vaccine? All live vaccines are contraindicated if the CD4 count is less than 200. The one exception is the Jynneos mpox vaccine, so that's something else to think about for your post-test questions. Is this a vaccine where seasonal timing is important? You're probably not going to defer a vaccine, the flu vaccine, if it's September and you're in the midst of a epidemic. Is there a vaccine for disease where an epidemic is occurring? Of course, during 2022 in the mpox, we were trying to get as many people vaccinated as possible. Is this a vaccine where data indicate a stronger response after CD4 recovery or virologic suppression? Well, most vaccines show this, that you know, ideally if people were, you know, had normal CD4 counts and suppressed viral load, that would be the optimal time to respond to a vaccine. How common is the disease that you're immunizing for? So you could probably safely defer a tetanus vaccine, since we don't seem to ever see it. And then has the patient recently had a disease you are vaccinating for might have some immunity. So there are guidelines from the CDC that if you've had COVID-19, you can safely wait 2 to 3 months before vaccinating again. And what I've done here in your slides, mostly just for your reference, is have a couple tables on the timing of vaccination in people with HIV and where those recommendations come from. So obviously vaccines play an important role in primary care. Many standard of care vaccines, and some specifically for people with HIV. We've talked about those kind of shared decision making, the HPV vaccine in older people, the RSV vaccine, for example. I think it's important to consider the mpox vaccine. I think we're at significant risk of seeing kind of these surges again of cases. And then we talked about new vaccines for respiratory diseases. And at that, I will stop and open it up for questions. And I'm going to move to this slide just so you can kind of look at the slide, because it might prompt you to say something.
Thank you very much, Steve. You can have a seat there, and I'll field the questions. Just as an FYI, one of the things I mentioned that the IAS-USA does is have very informal, what we call dialogues, focused on COVID, but not just. And one of our regular panelists is Bonnie Maldonado, who is an interesting person who's on the ACIP, so we often get a kind of heads up on changes in vaccines. Bonnie is also an interesting person for being a pediatrician ID person, but also now the chair of medicine at Stanford, so who knows? Lots of good questions. Do you check annual HBV surface antibody in vaccinated individuals? If so, do you vaccinate if someone initially had a protective titer but then drops below?
Yeah, so this is addressed in the federal guidelines. It's not a, I would say that our approach has typically been if people are, you know, immune reconstituted, respond to the vaccine and have surface antibody, we are not checking annually. But the guidelines do say some experts would consider doing that. And I would say anecdotally, when we've had people, for example, transfer practices and we check their labs, we find titers that have diminished. We have actually revaccinated those groups, but I would say we've not been routinely checking titers annually.
Great. I've got great questions here. Remind you that there are microphones if you have a question that you want to stand up and shout out. For patients who have received pneumococcal vaccinations 13 and 23, is there any harm in using PCV20, even though it's not really recommended?
No, and I would say in my practice I've had a low threshold to kind of give the PCV20 just because I feel like it's a, you know, it's a better vaccine. Again, we don't quite see the pneumococcal disease burden that we used to, but I've been giving that vaccine pretty frequently, kind of despite the fact that the guidelines would kind of say you're done until age 65.
So this is not a question from the audience, but something that we've seen in the news. Sort of this lingering series of questions on are there serious side effects of the COVID vaccines? I know that people read the news, people ask their docs about that. What's your comment on side effects of COVID vaccines?
Yeah, I think they're, you know, as a group of vaccines, they're incredibly safe. And I think, you know, the benefits still outweigh the risks. Can I mention one other thing?
Sure, of course, yeah.
You know, because I forgot to mention with the RSV vaccine, but at the latest ACIP meeting in February, there was a report of Guillain-Barré.
So I'm going to interrupt. Next question here was, any new information on potential neurologic adverse effects from RSV vaccine? News. Serious stuff.
Yeah, I have a plant in the audience.
Yeah.
If the initial MMWR that came out, there were a handful of neurologic events with both of the licensed RSV vaccines. If you read the MMWR, it was, you know, one of the reports was redacted, and one of the individuals was also getting the flu vaccine at the same time. It wasn't very clear. So at the ACIP meeting in February, there was a report of, I think, 13 cases with one vaccine and 11 with the other vaccine of Guillain-Barré out of a denominator of about 2 million. And it reached statistical significance for one vaccine and not quite for the other vaccine. And so this is going to be an area of ongoing study, is whether this is a risk. And I would add this to your kind of shared decision-making that there is a risk. The other RSV question that comes up is whether you're giving it to individuals under age 60. One of the vaccine manufacturers is looking at 50 to 59 as an indication, because we certainly have some HIV patients who are 57 with severe emphysema that I think would be a great candidate for the vaccine. But we have not been immunizing people with HIV less than 60. First of all, commercial pharmacies, which are usually giving these, age as an absolute cutoff. But we have our own pharmacy, but we've been giving it to lung transplant patients, other transplant patients. But we have not been giving it to people with HIV under age 60.
Great. This is a comment that the 2023 CDC revised guidelines now recommend Hep B vaccine for all non-immune persons without an upper age limit. Do you want to comment on that?
Yeah, so the Well, I'll have to double check that. You know, it was up to age 59 and then 60 and over with risk, but it's now universal.
No risk screening for Hep B.
Yeah.
You're going the same way as HIV and Hep C.
Yeah.
God, I now know who the anonymous person was that asked that question.
No, I appreciate that. Yeah, you're correct.
And anything about other strains of Mpox that are kicking around, sort of increase in DRC?
Well, I think there are different clades of the virus, like in DRC. I don't know what the implications will be for
U.S.,
U.S. or vaccine policy.
And then another question about Mpox vaccines. How about for healthcare workers? Proceduralists are asking if they should be vaccinated, especially for people doing aerosolized procedures, Bronx and the rest.
Yeah, I mean, we have not made that recommendation for healthcare workers. Certain laboratory workers that work with Mpox, you know, that's a candidate for vaccination. I think the risk to healthcare workers is extremely low.
Yes, question from the microphone.
So this is a sort of circular varicella question. Lots of people say they never had chickenpox. Most of them did, just don't know. Yeah. We haven't been checking levels. But hypothetically, if you had someone with no immunity to varicella, there's no harm in giving them the shingles shot instead or, you know, on top of that. Would that be protective? It seems like it would be protective against chickenpox because it's the same virus. And sort of the converse of that, the people who are currently vaccinated against varicella as children hypothetically shouldn't be getting zoster later. And at some point, are we going to say they don't need the shingle shot? Because I haven't seen any data about that. Thanks.
Well, the nice thing about giving a lot of lectures is you can have a previous lecture where somebody asked me that question and I didn't know it. And I was like, if people, I mean, we're not routinely screening for varicella, but if somebody is non-immune, like has a negative titer, the recommendations are to use the live varicella vaccine, the two-dose series. And then the question related to that is then do you give the recombinant zoster vaccine? And the answer is yes, after a minimum of 8 weeks after the second varicella dose. So, you know, I think, those individuals would get two varicella and then wait 8 weeks and then two recombinant.
What is their reasoning behind it? It seems like there's a much higher, the shingle shot is much more immunogenic and it seems like it would.
Why wouldn't it work, right?
Well, I think part of it is the absence of the kind of clinical trial that says that, because there has been work on recombinant varicella vaccines as kind of primary vaccines, but at this point it's not supplanted the current varicella vaccine, which is a live attenuated vaccine.
And then the flip question, if people are immune, have never had varicella, have varicella immunity from the vaccine, does they need the shingles shot?
The answer is yes. In other words, the vaccine is recommended regardless of prior chickenpox or prior varicella vaccination.
So I mentioned that IAS-USA, that the A is now antiviral. Another virus that's being talked about is bird flu. And you didn't mention it, but there was an editorial today in the New York Times about that, saying that, you know, we're ignoring the next possible pandemic. Any thoughts on bird flu and there's a vaccine kicking around? What's your reaction to that?
Yeah, there's work on the vaccine, of course. But, you know, at this point, you know, it's an epidemic in animals, but including animals that, you know, have contact with humans. I guess, you know, if it crosses over to humans significantly, that there'll be guidelines, but at this point, there aren't guidelines. There have been discussions about this also at the ACIP meetings. I keep mentioning the ACIP meetings, but if you go to the ACIP website, you can actually go to all of the meetings and download all the PowerPoint presentations, and it's really fascinating. There's a lot of information. But again, until I think that becomes a human
epidemic.
I think it's an interesting issue that, you know, having just kind of been through the COVID pandemic and having kind of questions about what do we learn from that, what do we, how are we preparing for the next possible pandemic? I don't have an answer to this, but I think it is a, it's a fair question to be asking, having been through that. So, Steve, thanks so much for your work.